second session, or maybe the third session, depending on how you count. We have a change in the people who will participate in this session. The first person who was scheduled, Ahmed Natur, from the Hebrew University in Jerusalem, is not here. His brother passed away. And so at the last moment, as we'll find out, we were fortunate to encourage Salman El-Bidour to come and join us, and he will speak later on a somewhat different topic. I want to start with Amal, who is a Bedouin woman, I'm told. Trust that you're right. She's at currently at McGill University in Montreal, which is a different country.
Yes,
and you'll find her information in this thing, so I won't repeat it. She's going to talk about between Sharia law, Israeli law, and traditions, the case of Bedouin women in Israel. So please welcome Amal to us.
Okay, well, thank you very much for inviting me for this panel. It's quite a challenging panel, dealing with the definition of the State of Israel and also relating to the minorities inside Israel within this definition. It's very challenging. I would like to thank you, Laura, for inviting me. Where is Laura? Okay. So first of all, I would like to, I don't want to talk about the definition of Israel is a Jewish state or a state for Jewish people. It's a huge topic, and it's still with its complexity around, and people are dealing with from the political point of view and from the a practical point of view. What's important for me is to talk about the case, how this definition, whether it's a Jewish state or a state for Jewish people, with these two definitions, still we have a challenge facing the minority living within the state of Israel as not Jewish. Defining Israel as a Jewish state or a democratic Jewish state with Israel democracy, there is a problem. With Israel Jewishness, there is a problem. So I don't want to go into there, but I want to talk about the implications. So when we are talking about Bedouin women, I want to put this within the larger context of the Arab minority inside Israel, where we today talking about 20% of the population inside Israel are Arabs. And within the 20% of the population, we are talking about 10% are Bedouins who are living in the Naqab Negev area, which is where I come from as a Bedouin. And we're talking about the situation where in all fields of life, we still talk about huge gaps between the Jewish majority and the Arab minority, and especially the Bedouin minority in the Negev area. We are still talking about basic needs that are not met by the State of Israel, where there are unrecognized villages, lack of water, electricity, and basic services. We are talking about 82,000 people who still live with what we call the unrecognized villages. So we're talking about the context where in a political context and also in a social and economical context, we are talking about many challenges that's still facing my community, but also if I wanna take this to the level of the state, this is one of the major challenges facing Israel today, where the big question is how the minority practice its full rights within the state that by definition is a democratic state. Is it democracy for all citizens, or it is democracy for Jewish people? And is the policy based on the definition of the state as a Jewish state? So if the policy is driven from that definition, what does this mean to me as an Arab, as a Bedouin, as a Palestinian citizen of the State of Israel? So all these questions still very big and very challenging for all of us. When it comes to the Bedouin women, as someone who started the first Bedouin women organization in Israel when I was 17 years old, the situation of women and also as a partitioners, as a social worker working with many cases of Bedouin women, we see that the challenge is being trapped between the Sharia law and the Israeli law and also the traditions. I call this journey as a social navigation process, where we women, and this is something, it's a case, but it's something also that I by myself experienced it as a woman, how you navigate your steps as a woman within these three spaces, that what's permitted in this space is forbidden in the other space, and what's okay in this space is not okay in that space. And this actually limits your space more and more and more, and you find yourself trying to navigate within a very limited space as a woman. And I call this the third, the three levels of oppression, the three levels of women trying to, you know, navigate herself within these three major issues. For example, if a Bedouin woman wants to marry, first there is a traditions that she's marrying according this to these traditions. The traditions mainly is something between the two fathers and the two families that they will agree upon this marriage. And they will guarantee, the two families will guarantee how this marriage will be sustained and what are the conditions of this contract, which is a traditional contract based on the Bedouin traditions and rules and laws and customs. And then for her to be a married woman, she needs to go to the Sharia, which is the Sharia court in Bir Saba and Beer Sheva. To be registered as a married woman. Otherwise, the Israeli law won't recognize her as a married woman. So I need to come with my contract that's signed by the Gadi, by the Sharia law, by the court, showing that I am already married. Now, the problem is and the challenge is that first it comes the Israeli law, and up here, the Israeli law is not clear if it's a Jewish law or a civic law. Go to the different level, which is the Sharia law. The Sharia law comes under the Israeli law, under the Jewish law, okay? So if I'm married by the Sharia law, and it one of the conditions of my contract is against the Israeli law, they will delete it from my contract because it should be under the Israeli law and the Jewish halachi, whatever. So it's very important to notice this. In children custody, when we are trying, in the traditions, the children belong to their father. And as women, since 2005, we are trying to have these issues, family law, operating outside of the Sharia law. So we started this group in Nazareth that we will go into the civic court. We didn't succeed yet in this challenge, trying to have more space for us as women. But still, if going back to the Sharia law that comes under the Israeli law, if the Sharia court would say that these kids are belong to their mother and there is something against the Israeli law, then the Israeli law will decide that the last word is for the Israeli law and not for the Sharia law. If the Sharia law goes together in a harmony with the Israeli law, it's accepted. If the Sharia law is not going in harmony with the Israeli law, it's not accepted. And this is one of the major challenges. Just giving one of the other examples that I dealt with what we call the single mothers issue. In the Sharia law, man can marry with more than one wife, right? It's the polygamy issue. It's forbidden by the Israeli law. Still, 30% of the Bedouin families have this, you know, extended family, what we call. So the woman would come to me as a social worker and she would say, well, you know, my husband got married with a second wife. I don't have any benefits. I have my children. He abandoned us. I have my children. I need to take care of my children. So I'll send her to the National Security Office. And in the National Security Office, they would say, oh, we are very sorry. We cannot recognize you as a single mother because you live within this, cultural form where you have extended families. And the women would say, well, you know, but I don't have any resources. I need the support of the state. It's a welfare. And when I started with this case, what is the definition of single mother in Israel? If you have a separate household, you are a single mother when it comes to the Jewish community. Even in Shchuna Dalit, when I went to visit some of the families, they share the same house. They just need to prove that they are not sharing this household. He's not supporting her, but because they live in Amidar apartment, they have to live together there because there is no other option for housing. When it comes to the Bedouin women, there is no recognition. We know that you are living in the same tribe, so you are already having this shared household, so there is no recognition, and this is why we don't want to give you any benefits. We went to these houses in Segev Shalom to try to see what's going on there. The inspector of the National Security Office found that there is a cable, electricity cable, links between the two houses, and he said, oh, they are actually running a shared household together, but it's one generator in the whole area that they have to share for electricity, and they didn't recognize this woman as a single mother. We took this case to the Supreme Court, trying to redefine what is the single mother means, what is the definition of a single mother, and what Bituach Lumi, what the security, National Security Office, you know how the Supreme Court will take a decision and then how they play with that decision in the bureaucrat offices. So the idea was, okay, no problem. We know how to recognize these women. The idea is, okay, he has three wives, right? Each wife has 3-4 kids. We'll bring all of them under the definition of extended families. Okay, not polygamy, extended families. We will take all the children under the father, register all the children, do the registration of all the children under the father, not under the mothers. And then there will be like one father, one house, and then all the benefits would go to father, exactly. So we solve the problem with another problem. Not only that, the idea of the National Security Office is that the first kid gets this percentage, the second, the more you have kids, the less you get money, the sixth child gets less than the second or the first. So for them, this is also giving less money when they put this kind of, you know, idea that all these kids will belong to the same father and leave the mothers without any kind of support. We went back to this to the National Insurance and we said, we don't accept this way to deal with the issue, and we want you to know that this woman is supporting herself by herself. We went to the Sharia court to support us in this, and they didn't support us. They said, we cannot give you any document that against the definition of single mothers by the state. We are under the state. So what's the meaning of having the Sharia court? It's only for my father to satisfy him that he's doing something according to the Sharia, or really there is a water that this that Sharia court holds. There is nothing that the Sharia court. Okay, you can say 4. I will take 8. Now I have 3. Okay, I'll make it short. So this is when you see that, okay, by definition there is a Sharia court in Israel, but by practice, there is no Sharia court in terms of, does this Sharia court has its power to affect the processes? So this is one. The second thing is like, okay, we have the Israeli law that prevent men from marrying with second or third women. There is a law that prevents this. It's supposedly against the law. What the police, what the Israeli institutions are doing to implement the law. The issue is, the situation is that there is no implementation. They are not preventing them from marrying with a second and third wife. And they are not taking care of this, the results of this marriage, which is the women, the abandoned women with the kids. And the National Security Office is not taking responsibility for this again. So you see how the victimization of women in this kind of three major big power systems that women are trying to navigate. Till this moment, there is no real power to the Sharia court. Till this moment, when it comes to the traditions, it's always kind of thinking, if the traditions goes very well with the state, then it's okay. But if the traditions goes against the state, it's not okay. So if we are talking about multiculturalism, if we are talking about the right of each community to practice its own, you know, culture and traditions, how the Israeli system guarantee this? There is no guarantee for this kind of culturally adaptation that people want to run their lives according to these systems. So for the Bedouin women today, situation is that we kept between three systems: traditions, Sharia law, and the Israeli law. None of them is perfect. None of them even better than 50%. None of them is providing the solution. We came to the court to try to find solution. Still, the women kept into these three major powers, and these three major powers are cooperating between themselves. The Islamic movement cooperate with the police. When the police is not taking anyone to file against him because he married with a second wife, they will release him the second day because they are men. In the police station, they are mainly men, and the Islamic movement are mainly men. So these are two powers that cooperate against the women. I will stop here. I know that there are many questions, but I will leave it for the Q&A after. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I feel that I'm in the enemy camp here.
Yes.
At least on one dimension. I'm not a Bedouin, and I'm not a woman. These are very tough. We're going to move from Bedouin women to evangelical Christians in Israel. Yaakov Ariel is going to make a presentation. Again, I won't repeat what's in the biography listed in this pamphlet. Yaakov?
First of all, thank you. I want to thank the organizers for this conference. I want to thank the organizers for this conference, for this opportunity, for the talks I've already heard and I will hear. But I also want to thank you for including the topic. Until very lately, examination of Christians and Israel, Christians in Israel, almost routinely excluded Protestants in general and evangelical Christians in particular. A lot of attention to the Catholic Church and its presence in the Holy Land, its relationship with the Israeli government, very often other churches too. And when evangelical Christianity in Israel is mentioned in the last decade or so, there's a renewed interest or a new interest, it's usually in connection only to the political implications of what is considered to be the evangelical enchantment, the unexpected, not always understood evangelical enchantment with Israel and with the Jews. Very little attention to other aspects and also to the enormity of the topic. Evangelical, there's no evangelical church. I mean, occasionally you will find the evangelical Lutheran church or a church that calls itself evangelical. We're talking here about the largest, most dynamic, most diverse movement within contemporary Protestantism, perhaps within contemporary Christianity at large. Relationships towards Israel and presence in Israel are therefore also extremely diverse, although we can point, and all I can do in the Sodom bed, in the minutes allocated to me, is just relate to general trends, although I would like to point also at times to the unusual or the less known, the even less known such as evangelicals in the Palestinian, in Palestinian society. There's very little attention to the theological roots of this enchantment, because there is an enchantment, but it's not just political, and sometimes it's not political. The some people do know that in general, evangelicals considered the Jews to be the chosen people. That's not always the case. But there's certainly a special interest in the Holy Land, and there is a special interest in the Jews. Holy Land for evangelical Christians, or at least for conservative, the conservative elements, the messianically oriented elements, is ground zero. It's ground zero historically. It's the place where Jesus preached, suffered, died, resurrected. It is the place to which Jesus will return shortly, because that's the understanding of a messianic movement. It's not something theoretical. It's the place where the major events of the end time are going to take place. It's the place where Jesus is going to reign in a restored Davidic kingdom, a global government. The Jerusalem is going to turn again, both first into the city of Antichrist and then into the center of the universe. Since the beginning of evangelical Christianity was, oh, in spite of, I'm being historical here, not theological, evangelical Christianity came on the scene in the English-speaking world at the turn of the 19th century. It became a truly global movement only during the 20th century, where you can find more evangelicals outside the English-speaking world than in it. It's still extremely influential, particularly in North America. From its inception, evangelical Christians took particular interest in the Holy Land and in the Jewish people, sometimes simultaneously, sometimes separately. There is not one evangelical group that is not represented in the Holy Land. Not so much as indigenous movements, also such movements exist, but as implemented representation of various global evangelical groups. We can play a game. I don't have the time to play it with you here, but I'm willing to be challenged. I'm willing to dare you. And we can play the game in the intermission. And the game would be, you will mention, each and every one of you, an evangelical church, denomination, major university, major mission, and I will tell you where they're headquartered in Israel. Not one group that isn't represented. This is now not something new. This is something historical in the sense that already in the 19th century, dozens of evangelical groups made a point of settling in Israel, sending missionaries there, building schools, building hospitals, sometimes settling as settlers wishing to expect at first hand the second coming of Jesus. Some of the most beautiful or intriguing neighborhoods of Jerusalem, Haifa, Tel Aviv, were built that way. Again, you can, willing to take you into a virtual tour. Those people played an enormous role in building an infrastructure in Palestine that made it congenial and more welcome to Jews to settle. Many of them helped the Jews directly and indirectly, among other ways, by setting an example of European-American neighborhoods, institutions, and economic enterprises in the Holy Land, not to mention, of course, that the educational and medical infrastructure was extremely helpful to the Jews. Let's go into the theology, and I will qualify immediately that I'm not speaking in the name of all evangelicals, but of those evangelicals who are more messianically oriented than others. This is a group that takes the Bible seriously, not only as the authoritative document for how to lead a Christian life on the individual and communal levels, but also as the word of God to humanity, as the place where you can find the key to the unraveling of history, to the both in the past, the present, and the future. This has been challenged, but evangelicals tend to read the Bible more, I'm not saying literally, but more literally than liberal or mainline Christian groups. And they tend to take it seriously. And they look upon the Old Testament as integral and central just as much as the New Testament. This is not always the case with all Christian groups. Another thing that so this is one major issue that makes people already interested in the Holy Land, in the Jews in particular. But, and in the 19th century, we would see many, many groups who would show up in Palestine oriented toward the Jews, but then shifting their attention also towards non-Jewish populations. But the duality there, which creates kind of interesting situation, is that on the one hand, evangelicals don't believe that people who are not born again in Christ, I'm using the modern American term, you can use other terms, that such people could be redeemed, could be justified before God, could enjoy eternal life. They see their mission, in bringing the truth of the gospel everywhere. They do not identify between church membership and being a true Christian or a redeemed human being. You have to undergo an inner experience of conversion, which at the peak of which you recognize Jesus as your personal savior. On the other hand, the Jews are something of an exception, not in the sense that they don't need Jesus, but in the sense that they are the chosen people. They are God's first nation. They are Jesus' brethren. This is one of a number of Christian groups, minority in Christian history, who do not consider the Jewish role in history to have ended and do believe that Jews have a role in history until the arrival of Jesus, separated from that of the church. As such, they are the brokers of the second coming. They need to return to Palestine. I'm talking about not something that was adopted in the last generation or two. They need to return to Palestine in unbelief, with the exception of a few Jews in every generation who convert and show that Jews are congenial and accepting towards conversion, and establish a commonwealth there. This is long before the Zionist movement came on the scene. Christian initiatives, Christian evangelical initiatives, political initiatives, economic initiatives, missionary initiatives at Jewish national revival and return to Palestine preceded the rise of political Zionism or even the proto-Zionist groups that formed at the later decades of the 19th century. When the Zionist movement came on the scene, it was offered enormous help from its evangelical Christian supporters. This is a chapter of Zionism that you won't find in Jewish histories of Zionism for two reasons. One was that during the glorified era of Zionism, before the post-Zionist era, Zionists didn't want to credit non-Jews in establishing their movement, in giving it legitimacy, in supporting it politically. It was all the founders of Zionism who've done that. And in the post, what you call the post-Zionist age, there's certainly very little interest in Christian visionaries, and particularly that historians of Zionism also are not exactly students of Christian theology or of Christian or of church history. But from its very inception, evangelicals directed unproportionately resources, manpower, hopes, prayers, efforts, ingenuities towards the Jewish scene, and particularly, I would say, towards the scene in Palestine. Again, something that is not always part, except marginally, of the history of the Holy Land and the history of Arab-Jewish relations. The British Mandate, and that's another chapter unknown, saw one of the missions of the British rule of Palestine, 1917 to 1948, was the protection of Christian groups in general, the protections of missionaries, particularly the favoring of Protestants, within that of the English-speaking Protestants, and within that, of course, of Anglicanism, but evangelical groups thrived under the British mandate. If you look at their histories, they showed up already during Ottoman rule. They enlarged, new groups showed up. By the 1920s and 30s were groups that were not always vital or always large during the Ottoman period, became active and apparent, including Pentecostal groups, and I won't go into those histories of evangelicalism and of evangelicalism in Palestine. State of Israel. I have to rush. I'm sweeping through history. Thank you, through history. 1948 is a tricky time for many evangelical groups. On the one hand, there is support for the birth of the State of Israel. There is some enthusiasm. Israel builds into the messianic scenario, but there's also a lot of apprehension. You'd be surprised, many evangelicals removed their representatives and sometimes even their constituencies prior to the establishment of State of Israel because they didn't know how the Jews are going to react to the presence of communities that were non-Jewish, Christian, and actively evangelizing. So there was a lot of apprehension in the first years of the state, contrary to a common myth that I hear repeated time and time again. Israel does not prohibit missionary activity. In fact, missionary activity in Israel is protected under law, but with a catch, or it was with a catch. Today it's much more prevalent. Israel took upon itself to protect Christian groups, Christians' institutions, respect their properties, and maintain the status quo ante bellum, which meant that if a missionary group had 29 representatives, this was the case with the Southern Baptists, they were allowed 29 representatives. That's how Israel understood it. You cannot suddenly send another 100 missionaries just because you're so enthusiastic about the creation of a Jewish state. There was more to it. Some Jews did think that that's the time to curtail missionary activity. There have been post-1977, with the rise in the political power of Orthodox political groups and with the rise to power of Menachem Begin, two things happened. I'm sweeping through history and trying to abide by your guillotine. On the one hand, a series of anti-missionaries law either implemented or contemplated. There was a missionary law that passed at first round in the Knesset, but not acted into law. On the one hand. On the other hand, of course, the embracing of conservative evangelicals by the Likud government and the Israeli establishment. So in the early years of the state, what we see is anti-missionary demonstrations, harassment, not fatal, but harassment of missionaries, of their materials, and so on. And on the other hand, on the missionary side and on the evangelical side in general, there is, on the one hand, support for Israel, and on the other hand, there's terrible frustration, not only with the non-separation of church and state and the limitation, won't call it curtailing, but limitations on presence in the Holy Land, but there's also frustration over the secular Zionist socialist ideology of the nation. The Jews don't understand why they're here. The Jews don't understand why their own state was established. The big watershed event is 1967, not only for many reasons, but particularly for evangelical-Israeli relationship. That's when evangelicals are certain that the state of Israel has been established for a purpose. It also correlates with the revival of evangelicalism in the United States and in Latin America. And what we see for the first time, speaking about evangelical presence in Israel, is the establishment, not just personal enthusiasm, not just veteran evangelical groups supporting, not just various missions and initiatives, we see the rise of pro-Israel political and economic groups, with some of them headquartered in Israel. One of the most known is the International Christian Embassy in Jerusalem, which is a unique group because it was established by non-American evangelicals, although nowadays America has managed to come to partially, not dominate, but be represented there as well. There's quite a number of such groups. The International Fellowship of Christians and Jews, the International Fellowship of Christians and Jews, the Jews there is one Jew, Orthodox Jew, Rabbi Yechiel Eckstein, but they have already collected hundreds of millions of dollars from evangelicals for various incidentally, so have done the International Christian Embassy in Jerusalem, for various projects, bringing immigrants, welfare. They work, since they are oriented towards the Jews more than towards the Palestinians, there are evangelical groups working among the Palestinians with very different ideological and theological perceptions, or sometimes with similar, but still working among the Palestinians. But in this case, hundreds of millions of dollars are directed towards welfare among needy Jews, mostly elderly, and you should include the Bedouins in that. Tell them that the Bedouins are part of the 10 lost tribes, and you'll see a whole change of attitude. Right.
We're going to thank Yaakov.
Oh my gosh. I only have done, but okay.
Now we have a movie that's going to be presented.
You see, the next speaker can show a whole movie.
Not quite.
This is Norit Novis Deutsch, who is both at the Hebrew University and as well in Haifa.
But it doesn't seem to be on the screen.
It's just to be on the screen. It's okay.
A minute. Here we go. I think it's shut. Yeah.
And she's going to talk about attitudes among religious Jews in Israel towards non-Jews. I assume includes both the Bedouin and the Protestant evangelicals.
Nope. That
does
not do the thing. Okay. Okay, so exactly good afternoon, I think. The human brain has a built-in preference for generalizations, but, right, thanks. But while I'd love to be able to offer a clear-cut answer to the question of my talk, which is, what are the attitudes of religious Jews in Israel towards non-Jews? Any answer I present will need to take into account three factors. How are these attitudes expressed? Who are the religious Jews we're talking about? And who are the non-Jews we are referring to? So we should first distinguish between attitudes expressed, there we go, in sacred texts, those expressed by religious leaders, and attitudes of lay people. So as a psychologist of religion, that's what I do, I will limit myself to the latter group, while noting, in passing, that the corpus of Jewish sacred texts and their ensuing interpretations contains more than enough variance to ground the most exclusionist and the most inclusivist of attitudes. So the question I'll really be asking is, what do people choose to read in these sacred texts and why? Okay. When assessing attitudes of individuals, it's important to sort of separate a bunch of levels. So to make a distinction between what people say they believe, what they think they believe, what they really believe, and then how they act that out in behavior. Time does not allow me to sift through these layers. I will only refer to what people say they believe. But in religious Israeli circles, this is usually enough. There is less of a need for sophisticated implicit attention tests of the sort used in the US when assessing prejudice and religion, and this is part of the issue. Religious exclusionist attitudes are just out there. I remember once interviewing a small group of Haredi women and hearing from them some beliefs, such as that non-Jews should not share the same hospitals with Jews, and that any knowledge imparted by a non-Jew is not worth acquiring. I remember that at some stage my professional neutrality wore thin, and I asked, are you aware that what you're expressing are racist attitudes? So one of them asked, in all sincerity, what do you mean by racism? Gizanut in Hebrew, it's not a word that they were using very often. And I tried to explain, and we had a talk. And then, after thinking it over, that woman said, well, if that's racism, then I'm a proud racist. These attitudes are not easy to hear. But the issue cannot be analyzed unless we explore them. However, an important caveat to keep in mind is that Israel is a democratic nation with an independent judiciary, which holds in check much of the negative opinions expressed by individuals. Thus, the attitudes we'll be looking at are quite a bit more extreme than their behavioral expressions. The patterns of religious violence in Israel are different from the ones I'm going to talk about. Just for one example, Haredim, who are consistently expressing the most extreme exclusionist attitudes, exhibit relatively low levels, or very low levels in most cases, of religious violence. So now let's just look for a minute at religious Jews, and that too is a placeholder. Many religious Jews in Israel would never consider believing in the kinds of attitudes I just mentioned. Here, let's just take a quick look at how the Israeli religious scene parses out. Following Professor Stern's illuminating talk, I just removed the numbers, which were from 2013, because it seems that they changed drastically, but you can still see the point is that to say Jewish religious is just to say something much too broad to be meaningful. Just one small example, I once conducted a study on religious liberal Jews in Israel. These would be, where are they? Right here. Okay? Makala.
So you're finished.
Yeah. Computer on this thing. Okay, here we go. So the liberal religious Jews, conservative and reform, to make it clear, a very small proportion of Israeli religious Jews, maybe 2%, there's some arguments about that too. In one study, they came out as more tolerant and more universalist than both secular and religious Jews in Israel. So what I'm going to say is you have to keep that in mind. So as many researchers in the U.S. have shown, and Canetti and a bunch of other researchers have shown this in Israel as well, when you control for everything else, religiosity per se is not the factor which predicts exclusionism. What you see here is that religiosity affects authoritarianism, which is connected to exclusionism, right, via a route of threat perception. I'll talk about that in a minute, but the point is, it's not just being religious that does all this. Finally, we should note that in Israel's multicultural society, there are representatives of very many religions and denominations. We heard the figure of 14 official religions. When you start counting denominations and not unofficial ones, you get to over 110, including new religions, which some people call cults. And there is no reason to believe that attitudes towards all of these non-Jewish groups are the same. There are many ways of parsing out these attitudes. I'll show you. Here are some of them. Okay? And you can parse them out different ways. This is how people think of religions in Israel. These are not theologically, perhaps, legitimate divisions. I'll just mention one concept that differentiates between the way religious people in Israel think of these different groups. And that concept is perceived threat. Which is considered to be the single best group-level predictor of exclusionism and intolerance. So perceived threat is the cognitive evaluation of how dangerous an outgroup may be to the goals of an in-group. And It can be either realistic or symbolic. In the context of religion, realistic would be that this other religion threatens Jewish life, the Jewish land, property. A symbolic threat would be that it threatens Jewish values, identity, and worldview. So the religions differ on this in terms of religious perception. Muslims are considered high on a realistic perceived threat, whereas the sort of missionary groups, Messianic Jews and many others, are high on symbolic threat for two reasons. A, some of them try to change who we are, right? That's missionizing. And B, some of them are just too close for comfort, right? They're almost like us. They say they're Jewish, but they're not. So that creates a different kind of problem. And other religions, such as the Druze religion, are actually very low on both kinds of perceived threat. They are loyal to the state of Israel, and they do not allow anybody into their religion who is not born Druze. So to sum up this first point, there is no single attitude of Judaism, of Jews, or even of Israeli religious Orthodox Jews towards non-Jews. You may be familiar with religious prejudice in Israel. Unfortunately, we have much too much of it. Here are some examples, counterexamples, of religious Jews fostering dialogue, interfaith, and battling racism in Israel. These are some of the groups, some of the programs that foster that, and they're organized by, or mostly by, religious Jewish individuals. Next, a huge obstacle that we need to overcome in trying to determine attitudes towards non-Jews stems from the fact that the largest religious minority, by far, in Israel, are the Sunni Muslims, who are also, for the most part, Palestinian Arabs. It is virtually impossible to distinguish between attitudes towards Arabs as an ethnic group involved in the conflict and attitudes towards Arab as Muslims. It's impossible, not for some methodological reason, because intrinsically, the two are intertwined in self-perception, in perceptions of religious Jews. There's a joke that's told about the conflict in Northern Ireland, which makes this point, I think, well. So the joke says that an armed man jumps out of the entrance to a house, holds a gun to the head of a passerby, and asks, "Catholic or Protestant?" "Well, actually," says the man, "I am an atheist." "Fine," replies the gunman, "but what kind of atheist are you, Catholic or Protestant?" So my second point is that the way to look at the attitudes of religious Jews towards non-Jews is sort of like a layered cake. There's an underlying level of anxiety that Yerushalmi called zachor, the collective injunction to remember persecution. It's shared by most Israeli Jews, but probably more salient for religious ones because they fulfill a bunch of commandments to remember persecution on various religion occasions. And a recent musical hit in the religious world has a really catchy tune to the following lyrics, which you might recognize from the Haggadah, the Passover Haggadah. "Not only one tried to destroy us, but in every generation they try to destroy us, and God saves us from their hands." Next comes the level of perceived socio-political threat, the protracted conflict level, right? And on top of that come the religious attitudes towards non-Jews. A case could be made for these attitudes forming the base of the cake as well. It's a question. But in any case, when you take a bite of the cake, you're biting into all of these layers at once. You can't separate them. Now that I've made this qualifying statement, a quick look at some data. I have a feeling I won't have time for all the data. I'll show you some. You're welcome to ask me. So here's something that you should recognize pretty well, Professor Stern. From the IDI, the Israel Democracy Index for 2013, the more religiously conservative a person in Israel is, the less they're willing to grant equal rights to non-Jews. This has been found time and again, not only in these index indices, but in others. Similarly, when people were asked whom they would not like for neighbors, the same pattern emerged. You can see very clearly a linear direction here. The more religious the group, the more rejecting of non-Jews. In this case, you see an Arab family, foreign workers, and the line just goes up. When we look at another survey from 2014, and we break down only the religious Zionist groups, okay? We find some interesting subdivisions, highlighting the point that the minute you stop generalizing, things change. So you say that religious Orthodox Jews are exclusionist, but look, here's a small group, or that's the other side, it's the orange one there, a small group of what you might call modern Orthodox, and they are far less exclusionist than mainstream Orthodox, with the National Haredi, just note this, even more exclusionist than the Haredim. So, something to think about. We have multiple sources of data to show that the more religious a person, the less they actually associate with people of other religions, and the more negative stereotypes they hold against that person. This may lead us to a hypothesis that unfamiliarity with the other may have something to do with religious prejudice. So in this survey, by the Tel Aviv University School of Education, they asked 536 teenagers, a representative sample, if they'd be willing to have a friend who is an Arab, same gender, same age. 23% of, they put them together here, secular and traditional Jews said, teenagers, yeah, said no. The rest said either yes or possibly. But a full 81% of Haredi and religious Zionist teenagers refused. This may explain the fact that in the same survey, an astounding 82% of religious teenagers believed that Arabs in Israel should not be granted equal rights. Finally, an interesting survey about Christians, one of the rare cases where we get to separate the Arab-Israel conflict from the religious issue, we see the same two trends. We see the more religious you are, the less you know Christians. In other words, the less familiarity, the less you know of Christianity. So I'll give you a small example here. 67% of religious Jews in this survey believe that Jerusalem is not a holy city for Christians. So this is kind of what Freud would call, I mean, it's a sort of an illusion, right? You want to believe that possibly, but still, it shows an incredible ignorance. And interestingly, the only religious Jews who didn't follow this were the ones who lived in Jerusalem. They knew. They could. Anyway, and then you can see that 85% of them don't know any Christians in the States, anywhere in the world, okay, or in Israel, versus 34% of the secular and traditional. And finally, 73% said that we should not teach anything about Christianity. And this is sort of the main point I want to talk about, elective ignorance. All right, there are many kinds of ignorance, but I'm talking about not knowing people and not knowing ideas. A choice not to know anything about other people's worldviews. And when it becomes extreme, people don't even know what it is they don't know. So I'm going to describe an anecdote of what elective religious ignorance looks like, less to do with religions of others, but I think the point will be made. So when I once taught Haredi students, MA woman students, I was giving a course on moral psychology, and we were talking about children's books and the moral psychology involved in them, okay? So we did a comparison. And we looked at some Haredi children's books. There's a whole thriving market out there, and they're very interesting. And then I compared them to a bunch of general Israeli children's books that I kind of grabbed off the shelf that morning from my kids' bookshelf. So, you know, I showed them a bunch of books. And when I raised one book, and they looked at the cover, I heard this sort of collective gasp. And I looked at the book, and I realized, oops, you know, look at Olivia, I shouldn't have brought that book. So I said, I'm sorry, I put the book down, and I continued. But then after class, I thought, I should apologize in person. There was a small group within that class of ultra-conservative, ultra-orthodox, and really sort of on the more extreme side. So I came up to these women, they tended to kind of stick together also after class, and I said to them, you know, I really want to apologize, I shouldn't have shown that book. And they said, oh yeah, what was that all about? So I said, well, what do you mean? She said, we heard this kind of collective gasp. We didn't know why everybody was so shocked. I said, well, you know, Olivia's a pig. So they said, so one of them says, oh, so that's what a pig looks like. She had not seen a picture of a pig in her life. So I'm finishing, it's my last, yeah. Peter Berger recently noted that modernity by nature is not a force of secularization, contrary to what you might think. It has that effect, but what it really does is foster diversity. It brings into one place, either cyberspace place or geographic space, a lot of multi- multiplicity of beliefs, attitudes, and worldviews. What religions do with this diversity, with this plethora of others, depends. American religions, for example, have turned the situation into a free market of religions, with incredible number of people shopping among religions, switching and trying out new religious identities. In this climate, knowledge of the others is a commodity worth having. And one of its results is the weakening of religious prejudice, as Putnam and Campbell have shown in their 2010 American Grace. By the way, the Jews in the U.S., you can see them right there. They are extremely pluralistic. You can see that 5% only believe that their religion is the one true faith holding the key to eternal life. And in fact, in one study at least, Orthodox Jewry topped that list, which was interesting, intolerance and religious tolerance. But there is another option, and I believe that Israel is somewhere in the vicinity of the other option, unfortunately. It is when the need to face so many others, juxtaposed with the search for a single unified truth, and all of this in a confusing modern world, in the context of political conflict and perceived threat, leads to a reaction of closing inwards and choosing not to know. In Israel today, there is a virtual lack of studies about other religious traditions in all educational frameworks, especially the religious. When the other is unknown, he is threatening. But when he becomes unknowable, our imagination can turn him into a nightmare of the ultimate threat. In sum, to argue that religion or Judaism per se facilitates exclusionism is to simplify a complex story. It is more the choice of how one holds on to one's religion, as well as the cultural and socio-political context, that dictates how the link between religiosity and exclusionism will play out. Thank you.
Thank you. We have a very special guest speaker who I got in touch with yesterday morning. So we are extraordinarily pleased that he was able to join us and agree. His name is Dr. Salman Elbador, who teaches at Howard University, who's a psychologist and has looked at a variety of things associated with the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, on Israelis and Palestinian and Bedouin youth. He's done some very interesting work. He's got a PhD from University of Minnesota and has taught at, among other places, Beer Zeit, as well as in Howard University here in Washington. So I'm very pleased that you agreed and you grace our group of speakers. Thank you.
Thank you for inviting me. I'm from scholar Ahmed Nathur. I think he knows much better than me about religions. I don't pray, but I am the observer. You know, being a minority, I think much better even here.
We can't
hear you.
We can't see you. You're backlit.
Yeah. We can't see you because of the light.
The light behind.
All right. We have to listen louder.
Yeah, I think being a minority, you know, from Israel, you know, and to speak about issues that relate to Israeli Arab, you know, there is always orientations. I'm also a psychologist, you know. Minority is always, you know, we have this kind of the distress orientation. We look at things from absolutely from marginalizations, from, you know, subordinations, from powerlessness, you know, when it comes to any phenomena that we study about the Israeli society. I like Amel's perspective, it's more a little bit inclusive. She looks at the, you know, hope, the more the strength that the Israeli society has. So we're trying, I think, Amel, this is the first, you know, speaker to speak from really the strength, the combination of the deficit and the strength of the Israeli society. I'm going to speak about really the radicalization of the Arab community in Israel, you know. I think this is a becoming a serious issue within the Israeli society. The Arabs becoming more radical Muslims. In fact, a few years ago, I have conducted a study, you know, what is really the most prominent identity that you have? Is it tribal identity? Is it civil identity? Is it social identity? Is it extended family unity or Islam? And we're speaking, you know, this study has been conducted within the Bedouin community, which is almost 30 years ago, just a few people are praying. Here are the results, really. 48% says Islam is the most prominent identity for me. 11% says the extended tribal system is the most pronounced identity. This is a serious shift if you think about it from 30 years ago. One time, the identity of the Israeli Arab in general, including the Bedouin, it was a little bit really horizontal. There are those who are farmers, those who are Bedouins, and those who are what? Citizen or in cities. Today it's becoming, you know, you can see at once there is integrating the political situation in the Middle East. It's rather than the city, rather than the farmer, rather than the Bedouin, it's becoming, you know, integrating the political context of the Middle East. The other question that was speaking about, you know, what type of other identity that you see yourself? Israeli Arab, Arab Palestinians? I think, you know, the results were a little bit really encouraging. They see themselves both Israeli Arab and Arab Palestinians. But Arab Palestinians are more prominent. So more and more we can see that, you know, the issues of radical Islam is coming to the Bedouin community. In fact, 2 days ago, I think Abul Gian, one Bedouin guy, in fact, a bunch of them, they completed their PhD in medicine somewhere in Europe. They came to the Negev. Within a few minutes, they took themselves back to Syria, to Turkey, to join what? Daesh and the ISIS. One of them, Manal, died from Abul Gian. Why this phenomenon? You know, why suddenly the intensifying of the Islamization within the Bedouin community? You know, we look at really the Bedouin community or the Arab community, if we want to look at it, we need to look at it from the nested self. This is a type of community, Israel Arab is really stuck, but the best thing to describe them, nested self. Nested in a tribe, nested in Israel society, nested in a Palestinian community. So the best thing to see them, nested self. And the best thing about to see them also by the Israeli Jewish, that they belong to both. While, you know, while Laura is inviting me to speak, why this, you know, why this Islamization? Why radicalization? I think if you go and tour Rahat, you will see more mosque than schools. 10 years ago, I think my first time to go back to Israel, I was the only one, and my American wife and my brother Down syndrome who does not pray. And everybody is going to the mosque. So if you think about this phenomena, you need to think it about the hope and despair. Think about it from, I'm trying to list a number of factors here that are really intensifying this phenomena within the Israeli Arab community. It's becoming a serious issue. It's become radicalization. And I think, you know, it's a kind of mirror image to what happens with Hamas. If you think about it in the long run. So the first, I think, you know, first of all, there is a symbolic threat and there is real threat to their community. I mean, the whole community extended family has collapsed. The tribal system has collapsed. So the movement, the sudden shift from the collectivism to the individualism, in sudden, urbanization is a serious traumatic event to many of them, and particularly the Bedouin. Sudden, overwhelming, social change without a preparation. The Bedouin community is absolutely in a crisis when it comes suddenly, externally imposed a transition on them. This is a serious factor. They lost the community. Thus, they lost the tribal system, buffer system that really buffer them from stress, fears, and also in hard times. The second reason, I think there is a high concentration of poverty among this community. Wherever you see high concentration of poverty, high concentration of crowdedness, you know, crowd communities, wherever you see more children than ought to be in the community, the average age of the Bedouin community, you know, size family is around 11. At once you connect yourself with the Jabalia or all of these Gaza refugee camps. There is a place where is violence, radical thinking breeds. Concentration of poverty, impoverished, crowded places, and high concentration of children. Understand this is absolutely warning sign for radical and violence thinking. Within the Bedouin community and Israeli Arab, absolutely, I think 30% Amel knows are unemployed. I think the rate is much higher among females. So think about it, really, a little bit unemployed, concentration of camps, hope and helplessness. Absolutely, you are more likely to what? With the collapse of the community, the collapse of the symbolic father, you need a symbolic father, which become the mosque and the religious influential guy. The role of the family, the role of extended family, the role of the patriarchy is collapsing. And above that, the concentration, the unemployment, the poverty, you need to look for what? Simple father. You know, the father here is becoming the mosque and the imam. All of these last guys, last, you know, generation, right now, I think, if lots of them are marginalized. They search to go to the mosque because absolutely the really gratification in life that they cannot find in employment, they can, at least they can find it in their symbolic gratification. You think about also the Israeli Arab and their position. They are really in a kind of joint partnership or joint identity, Palestinians and Israeli. Now, the Israeli society, with all of the progress, and I really think the best minority to live are the Israeli minority. I teach at Howard for 10 years, and I always say, sometimes sometimes you don't see things unless you go outside. And any tour to Arab countries, they will tell you that our situation is really good. But still we need to improve it. The idea of oppressed psychology here. I think as a minority, we always see ourselves as oppressed in Israel by some laws. Why is, let us say, some rights are awarded based on your race and not your citizenship. Me, although I speak highly of Israel as a minority and I'm proud of it, at once when I go to the Israeli airport, suddenly I am the suspicious guy. It's a kind of really oppressed psychology. Why can't I feel I belong there? Why suddenly, and only at the airport, at once I'm reminded of my, that I don't belong. And it's really not inside Israel. So at least, you know, I hope, Manal, I hope you don't have this experience.
I do.
Okay.
More than you, because I have a scarf also.
Yeah, usually, yeah.
Usually you go with your scarf, I think.
Anyway, some of these laws are really awarded based on, just like being, you know, based on your race and not heritage. This is really bad. And it should be a challenge in Israel. Second, I think, you know, oftentimes this phenomena of radical, whether in Hamas, I say, or whether in the Bedouin, it's coming. You know, the best way is to integrate. Integrate the community in the social, cultural, political system. In Israel, sometimes I go to the post office, I find a nice woman with a scarf, a token economy. Why she has to be a token economy? We are Israeli. Why can't I see 20% at least presentation in Israel or in Beersheba? Why we need some token economist? So, to eliminate radical thinking, extremist, to eliminate or replace the role of the mosque, It's integration in the Israeli institutions. Because anybody will say, you know, closing the system, closing the integration system, you end either in two, as a minority. You, whether here, whether in Ireland, anywhere. There is two avenues. Drug use, radicalization. And this is what happened today in the Israeli society. You know, although with all of the efforts, we need more efforts to integrate the community, to integrate the Arab community and the Bedouin community in the social services and the culture initiatives in everything. And this is the only way I think we can restore hope in the Bedouin or Israeli Arab. Although, again, they need also to be optimist. The only way is to compare, to go to Jordan. Going to Mecca is excellent frame of reference that we are achieving lots of good things in Israel. But still, there is no place to blame, but you know, we need to integrate them more in the Israeli society. Thank you very much.
Calvin, talking to the microphone.
They will hear me. Let's open the floor up. There are people, I'm sure, have many, many questions. And so let's take a few questions, and then we'll get some answers. Yes?
Oh, wait.
Wait
till
the microphone.
Why?
Why, thank you.
Please.
She came a long way.
All the way from Boston. I'm Amber Taylor. I'm from Brandeis University. I wanted to thank you all. What a fascinating discussion. I really appreciate all your thoughts. I want to direct my comments to Professor Ariel and ask, you didn't have enough time. I think you were going there, but maybe I'll help direct, open up the opportunity to talk a little bit more specifically about the evangelical relations with others besides Jews in Israel. And how they, in perceptions, and how that has changed and shifted, particularly in more recent decades.
You want to answer them, or shall we get a couple of questions first?
It's up to you. I'm more than happy to answer.
Okay. If it's brief, you can answer.
I think you raised a very important point, because the evangelical relationship is not just with the Jews, it's also with non-Jews. There's always been, incidentally, evangelicals involved with the Arab population. Sometimes involvement, incidentally, in Palestine or the Holy Land or Israel with certain groups also influences the direction of the group at large, even outside of the country. We can show a few examples of that, both among evangelicals and mainline Protestants. But one of the things you want to speak about is shifting of opinions or attitudes. I'd like to point out that even in the 1950s and 60s, prior to 1967, when evangelicals were trying to make sense of Israel, there were many things they liked and there were many things they did not like, some of which I pointed to. There, and you can see it even in people like Welvard, who was messianically oriented, the president of Dallas Theological Seminary, wrote about Israel in history, Israel in prophecy, and wanted to make sense as far as evangelical theology, where does Israel fit in? Even then, there were criticisms, there was awareness of the plight of Palestinians in 1948 and the refugees. There was a claim that the international community should pay attention not only to the needs of Jewish immigrants and Jewish settlers in Israel, but to Palestinian needs as well, and that Israel had a duty to treat its Arab population fairly. So you see there's agreement here. But there was always also the claim, which is still there, that the country, even when more immigration comes in, even when refugees are resettled, the country can handle both Jews and Arabs. At that time, you spoke more about Arabs and Arab refugees than Palestinians. And that those people can live near each other or with each other in peace. There were you can look at a history of what you could call Palestinian-Israeli evangelical relationship, which have soured following the First Intifada considerably, and that's where the border started forming between what you could call pro-Palestinian evangelicals and pro-Israeli evangelicals, with a lot of bitterness on both sides, both among the indigenous communities, the evangelicals settling in the country, and outside of the country. What we see outside of Israel in the last decade, mostly, is a shifting of opinion from the enchantment, the over-enthusiasm, if you will, of the late 1960s, 1970s, 1980s, of conservative evangelicals. I'm not now even talking about progressive evangelicals, I'm talking about conservative evangelicals because those are the people I spoke about. We can see a certain shift. It's not that Israel is being necessarily rejected so much as there's much more criticism and much more apprehension and much more demand for what you could call more political justice. In that incident, just as I was speaking about evangelicals as supporters and builders of Zionism alongside the Jews, you can see a correlation here, incidentally, about the attitudes of American Jewry towards Israel and evangelical Christians towards Israel.
Can we get a microphone over here, please?
Hi, thank you. I'm Gil Shamir. Thank you for putting this together, and thank you for a very good panel. I'm kind of curious about the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. The Mormons, they don't seem to fall into the evangelical camp, yet there seem to be some similarities, I think, amongst LDS and at least some evangelicals. Can you talk a little bit about the LDS Church and Brigham Young University and its approach to Zionism, to Israel, to society within Israel and the many groups within the country?
Well, I hope that I'm not going to be here monopolizing the panel because I actually admired the three presentations of my friends here, so I'd like to hear them more. But just to answer that, yes, you stated it. The major Mormon church, the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, is not an evangelical group. In fact, until lately, now there are serious attempts at rapprochement and dialogue. Till lately, there was a lot of tension between evangelicals and Mormons, among other reasons because they're so similar. And they are similar in their attitude towards Zionism because the founder of the Mormon Church, won't go into this ancient history, but early Mormons and throughout the 19th century and early 20th century and mid-20th century, many Mormon leaders, including major leaders, were clearly what you could call Christian Zionists. There is there too a shift in the last 20 years. Ironically, part of the shift is because of the Brigham Center in Jerusalem, which was given as a present. The land was given something of a present, initiated by Teddy Kollek. The Mormon group was in the 60s and 70s until the mid 80s, was located in Ramat Rachel, the south of Jerusalem, very clearly pro-Israeli. Kollek, who also was a founder in some ways, or Israeli supporters of the International Christian Embassy, very much wanted to encourage this pro-Israeli, pro-Kollek group. But the truth is that building the center in what is actually an Arab neighborhood, an Arab part of Jerusalem, particularly after the First Intifada, turned that center into a much more politically cautious group, aiming at more neutrality, more looking impartially at both sides. If you come to the center as a student from Brigham Young University, you will find that you need to spend time both with Palestinian families and in Israeli kibbutz. You study both Arabic and Hebrew. You're taught about Middle Eastern issues both by Jews and by Arabs, which wasn't the case until that particular center was built. Because of the Second Intifada, the center was even frozen for a few years, and Brigham Young didn't send students there. So this is actually a good example of a situation in which involvement, actual presence in the country, changes the policies of the mother church or mother group, if you will. Today, if you'd ask me, I would say the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints does not have a clear theological policy on Israel. It's friendly, it's supportive, but you can take many views. It's not part of the Mormon tenets of faith to be a Christian Zionist. And so, but you'll find a lot of such material and you'll find a lot of sympathy. And in actuality, as far also as political support, Mormons representatives, Mormons like Jews, now into conspiracy theories almost, Mormon like Jews are overrepresented in Washington in corridors of powers, if you look at numbers. And the attitude on the other is extremely supportive, but it's much more critical than it used to be between 67 and 87.
Hi, everyone. My name is Jad Abu Salim. I'm from New York University. My question is about the image of the non-Jew and the perception of the non-Jew in Israel, and how does education influence this this image? Now, in the current reality of education in Israel, to what extent the history of Islam and Christianity are being taught, and how they are seen? For example, if we talk about teaching the history of 17th century Palestine under the Ottoman Empire, how is this history being taught? Is the Arab or Islamic presence in this period is it being seen as something native? Is it being taught in detail? Because I have to mention this. I was teaching a class for Palestinian and Israeli students, and one Israeli student was surprised for the first time in his life to know that that Muslims worship the same God that Jews worship, and then we had a conversation about how not sufficient education on other religions or other cultures in Israel is. And the other part of the question has to do with the idea of Israel as a Western state in the Middle East. This quote, villa in the jungle mentality that Ehud Barak once used this term, how does it influence the Israelis' perception of the others, especially when it comes to their Arab or Muslim counterparts? Thank you.
Do you want to collect questions or should I answer?
I think we ought to collect a few questions and then people can answer.
I wrote
them. Please.
I don't think I need a microphone. This is a question for Amal, and Salman can add to it if he wishes. Amal, I think you did a really fine job in showing the complexity of navigating social systems for a Bedouin woman. But I'm interested to know how a woman who has a Bedouin heritage and is secular manages those intricate balancings. She wants to be part of the community. She may not follow Sharia law, but she feels a deep respect and affection and homage for the tradition. How does she play into this? And what changes do you see in those imams and others who are dealing with Sharia law? Are there factions? There must be. More moderate, more conservative, more liberal? Do people go to Al-Azhar? Where are they going to study traditions? Perhaps somewhere in Israel, but I'd like to know more broadly. Anything you want to add, Salman, would be good too.
Just give it to a few people and get some questions.
Hi, my name is Jessica Simon. I work at the New Israel Fund, and I'm here. And because I've had the privilege to meet so many leaders in civil society in Israel, I was wondering if you could comment a little bit about how does that play into attitudes towards minority groups in Israel, and if you in your research have found, are there any predictors of those who are more likely to get involved in sort of promoting the rights of non-Jews?
Hi, my name is Rachel Wolf. I'm a junior here at American University. And my question is actually for Mr. Albador. You were talking about integrating Arabs into Israeli society. And you focused on this part of the Arab population that's already sort of having this radicalized thinking, this violent thinking. Is there a willingness among that population to be integrated through Israeli integration efforts? And if so, what sort of efforts would you suggest doing? How would you suggest making this, I guess, a more inclusive society? Thank you.
Hi, my name is Naomi Neuerman. I'm actually an Israeli, but I've lived here many years. I would like to raise a subject which may be taboo, but the question of what is the attitude, religious or otherwise, towards having lots of children, especially when you're not in the position of supporting them, educating them, making sure that you're responsible for them as parents, not to mention from a societal perspective. Seems to me that part of our problem is that we have lots of kids that are not taken care of by those who are their parents, and we end up with an excess amount of lost kids, as it were. And the question is, what can we do as a society, as men who in many groups make those decisions, and can it be a policy at all, or does it have to be an individual responsibility?
One more.
Thank you. Rabbi Fred Scherlinder-Dab, a local rabbi and AU Park resident. Dr. Novis-Deutsch's research feels to my American Jewish self as absolutely central. And it's the key to unlocking the ability for the Amals and the Sulmans and so many others to be heard. So I want to introduce the same question that Dr. Nadel introduced at the end of the previous panel, the dialogue with American Judaism and American values in general. It's worth noting a certain preponderance of Western Olim behind some of the organizations that you've cited. And I don't want this to be about an American Jewish triumphalism. I do want it to be about a very creative and mutually enriching dialogue that increasingly becomes a trialogue with the minority groups in Israel and the American Jewish community. And in that regard, I'm so delighted that you're both on this panel. Thank you.
Can we get the microphone over this side just for a minute? And we'll have...
You're writing all these questions
down? Yes, I have them all written down. Two questions. Over here.
I'm Bruce Kutnick. I have a question about minorities in Israel, dealing specifically with the textbooks that are being used in classes. Who select them? Has there been an analysis done? I expect they're in Arabic, okay. But has there been a comparison of the content of the textbooks that are being used, elementary through high school, compared to those that are being used in by Jews, secular Jews, forget the religious, they have their own school. I just wondered, what is the content of these textbooks?
One final question.
Sorry. I think we have two.
That's fine.
This is for Amal. I saw, because I Googled you, that you're a graduate of Ben-Gurion University in the Negev, and I wondered if you could just say a few words what it's like for a young Bedouin woman to go to a major Israeli university.
We're going to ask the panel individually to respond to whatever questions they want to. I have one footnote question, which is the word that I would use to describe the relationship between Arab Israelis and Jewish Israelis would be discrimination. And I didn't hear that at all. I had it inferred. But it seems to me that that's a powerful element that's involved, not only the transformation of the Arab community, not only their urbanization, not only their modernization and their high levels of education now, but rather the serious discrimination that occurs both in the workplace and in other areas. So you can address it or ignore it. I can handle rejection. Solomon, since we ended with you, why don't we start with you? Just answer whatever elements that you want here.
I will answer I'll answer the question that Amal, I think, emphasized the Sharia
And what else the Israeli law, yeah? I think in Israel, and I'm a Bedouin, it seemed to me that I think, you know, there is multiple other dimensions that are also working on the individual. It's me, for instance, or I think, you know, Amalkan speaks on the, you know, the experience of women. I think I'm more arrested, really, by the tribal customs rather than the Sharia and then the Israeli law. In fact, I sent to Laura 2 weeks ago or 3 days ago article that, you know, the conflict between the Israeli law and the tribal law. The Sharia is really less emphasized, it seemed to me, but in cases of, you know, courts, divorce, and these things suddenly are pronounced. But women, and the Bedouin women, are more really controlled by the tribal system law, and not the Sharia, and not what we call it. Some of the custom comes thousands of years before the Islam, the tribal law. And I think that is, I think, you know, one dimension that has not been emphasized here. My mother, she does not know anything about Islam. Who controls her? Who really, you know, all of this, her behavior is really absolutely driven from culture, from customs, from tribal psychology. So that's, I think, you know, we need to, even in conflict, you know, speaking about conflict between tribes, sometimes, yes, the Israeli law. But where the, even the judge will tell the, you know, why don't you go finish it based on the tribal law? So the tribal law sometimes absolutely more pronounced in our culture, more motivating and driving our behaviors. That is, I think, you know, need to be a little bit stressed.
Okay.
Thanks.
Sorry.
Ahmed.
Okay. So let me start with talking about the textbooks, since a couple of you asked about that. There have been several studies, a few qualitative, I can think of at least three quantitative ones, a recent one, 2013 by Bartal. What they seem to be showing is, if I had to, like, you know, sum it all in a sentence, there is more lack of teaching than actual biases. Okay, so I'll add, over the past decade, there has been an improvement, I guess you would call it, in the level of bias. In other words, there is less bias today in textbooks, both in the religious Jewish and in the general Jewish educational system. However, the problem is more transparency. Okay, so yes, they teach history, you were asking, right? Not a ton, not a lot, but they don't teach too much of anything. Not too much history, not too much culture, but those are the ones that are covered, okay, history and culture. Where it gets to be a problem is worldviews, religion, nada. That is not covered, or you know, very little. They mention the five pillars of Islam, but that's about where it gets to. And I see that as the big problem. I very much believe that we need to have that as something that students are exposed to. They should know about the Mormons, if you ask. They should know about all of these wonderful, interesting, diverse religions, and they're not learning about them. What else can I say? The concept of God. I will say something about that, because that's my main topic of study, God concepts. And interestingly, I was just watching a program, documentary, excuse me, on Israeli TV, where a settler was saying out loud in front of the cameras, you know, in an interview, he said, "I'm sorry, I don't subscribe to this idea of the three monotheistic religions club. It's not the same God. We do not." That's what he said, and he gave a whole explanation. I was like, my jaw dropped. But he actually explained why the three gods, as it were, are not the same, even theologically in a basic. So even that, you can't assume that people will agree, unfortunately. The question of predictors of who gets involved in promoting the rights of non-Jews is a fascinating question. It's not so much about lay people, right? So I haven't looked at that so much. It would be more on a leadership study level. It's something to think about for next time. What else? Yes, the dialogue with American Judaism. I totally agree. I think that this is one of the places where American Judaism should be most influential, sort of like tag on to what Professor Kaplan ended with, talking about how American Jews relate to the fact that liberal Judaism is not appreciated fully
to be very gentle about it, this should be a place where a stand should be taken, because there's something liberal Jews have to teach, but something for Israelis to learn about. I completed a study in Berkeley about Orthodox religious Jews there who manage somehow or other to put together very committed Judaism and somewhat traditional God concepts. I wouldn't go that far, but and a pluralistic attitude towards others, all kinds of others. And I wish this was something we could bring to Israel. This should be an important thing. The question about children, I'm not quite sure, you know, to what degree it connects to the topic we were talking about. I'll just note very quickly that there is more and more awareness of it within halachic religious leadership. The number of children is high, but there are now attempts to help families who feel that they're overloaded to such a degree that they're not managing to take care of their kids. There are now more and more attempts to address that within rabbinic circles.
Cope, do you want to add something quickly?
No, I think I spoke enough.
Okay, well, I have 8 points.
Could you share some of that with Yaakov?
No, sorry. No, I will start with two points that were raised by Dr. Salman. And I want to elaborate on this in terms of are we really should compare ourselves to Arab countries, other minorities in other Arab countries? My answer is no. I'm comparing myself with other minorities living in democratic states. So there is no way to compare me as a minority, my situation, with the Jordanian minority, because in Jordan, it's a dictatorship. In Israel, it's a democracy. So for me, in democracy, minority rights is essential part. So compare me with you guys in America, okay? The Jewish minority in America. This is my group that I would be ready to compare, and not with Jordanians. The other point about the vacuum that we left our kids, and then the mosque became the place where to go. Well, I was raised in a family where my grandmother, my father used to pray every day 5 times a day, and I never felt that it's kind of oppression, because my parents and my grandmother saw religion as a spiritual thing, as a cultural tradition that we sit together and we eat and we talk and we laugh and we enjoy. It's the process of Islamization that became Islam, the political Islam that now is oppressing people and oppressing women and oppressing others. And this is where I feel the problem with Islam. I don't feel that there is a problem with the mask that I use as a child to go and get candies from there. My problem with the mask that it became a place where there is no place for me and for my values and for my plural thinking. Okay, so it's the way that if you think about the minority, the Arab minority inside Israel, we don't have youth movements, guys. You all went to a Hashomer HaTzair, you went to a Noar Oved Velomed, you went to the Scouts. We didn't, and your personalities got shaped by going to this youth movements, not by learning math and Hebrew and history, right? So can you imagine that the kids in the Bedouin community finish school at 2, and then from 2 till 8, there is nothing to do because there is no certain movements that they can join and design and build up their personalities, and there is views and standpoints. So this is what left the mask as a place that others would use it to fill these minds with stuff that none of us wants to see, and not for my children also to see. The third point, no, they don't teach us about Islam in the school. I learned Tehillim, I learned Tanakh, I learned the history of Jewish people and Leil Habdulach, I learned Megillat Rut, and I'm glad. I'm glad I did. I'm proud of this part of knowledge, because this is what opened me up to my Jewish partners, because I know you guys. I'm there because I built a huge organization, Arab Jewish Partnership, based on knowing you. Okay, so for me, this is a very important part. But with that, to cut me off of my culture and to minimize the Bedouin culture on riding on the donkey, sitting in the Bedouin tent and drinking 3 cups of coffees, and what's the meaning of this 3 cups of coffees? This is not me. This is only what the Western wants to see me as. There is many things behind this cup of coffee, many things behind this tent, and who weaved that tent, and who decided that this tent would be located here and not there was my grandmother, was the women. So the power of women in my community as a traditional community was very strong at these days. I agree with Salman about this transition and what my mother lost in that process of change, that all of a sudden the tent that used to provide her with the meaning of production and as a producer into a woman that she's a consumer and not having a meaningful job that influenced her status. Integration efforts. There is no integration efforts made by Israel to integrate the Arab community. There is a situation where Israel defines itself a place for one nation. So multiculturalism is not one of the values that Israel, by its policy, trying to provide. We know one policy by Ben-Gurion, which is the melting pot, right? Kura ha-chituch. All of us should be the same. And this is how we're gonna work it out as a one nation. So the efforts of integration weren't there based on multiculturalism, that each culture has its right to exist. It's assimilation, and assimilation is something that I can't live with it. I don't wanna give up who I am in order to be Michael's friend. I wanna be Amal, and I wanna be Michael's friend as Amal, who's proud of who she is and her culture. So the efforts that have been made are mostly focused in assimilation and not integration. And this is why it failed in the Israeli society, by thinking that by assimilation, the Arab kids, by the books that we read and we taught by, is one of the big mistakes. And this is what will bring me, as also a member of the New Israel board, to the role of the civil society, where if you live, not in the academia, if you live among the civil society movement in Israel, among the NGOs, non-governmental organization, you will feel and you will have a different feeling. These organizations are the organization that by doing, they are promoting the shared space in Israel. By doing and protecting people's rights, they are building this shared space in Israel where Arabs and Jewish, Palestinians, Christian, Druze are willing to share and to sit together and to work together. So for me, as someone who for many years still will go back and again to the civil society, I think that the civil society movement in Israel is one of the manua katizilat. Yeah, that will promote the civil rights movement in Israel. Kids and religion. Yes, I think this question is very related to religion. When I started with the small and medium enterprises with Bedouin women in 2002, trying to bring women out from the kitchen and to have their own small businesses, the idea was that, okay, I want to use religion to bring women out. So I used one sentence in Islam says that you don't have to have a child every year. Give yourself a time. So I used religion for this matter. So I succeeded to bring out women to be photographer, DJs, and today we have a big catering program in Hura, where we provide 8,000 meals a day provided by Bedouin women to schools in Hura. So I'm giving these examples because I believe that we have to utilize the traditional resources, whether it's religion or traditions or culture, to empower women and to empower ourselves. And this is for your question. This is exactly my theory of change. That when I look at my community, I don't see them as needy people. I see my people as people who has strength, abilities, and I build the programs on these strength and abilities. When I first started to recruit girls to the university to join me at BGU, I was without a scarf. I still with curly hair. So curly hair for my, and Salman also knows how people view women going around with curly hair as wild women, has no rules, no, you know, she's not behaved, well behaved. So the first two, you know, outreaches that I made when I was going around to convince the parents to send the girls to the university, I felt that they were looking at my hair more than listening to my words. And I decided that my words are more important than my curly hair. And I put the scarf, and for me, it was something that I'm respecting my people, I respect my traditions. It's not a symbol of oppression. I'm proud of who I am, and I feel like I love the blue color and I love my scarf. So this is the way I felt that I navigate my steps in between the culture that I come from and religion and being in the Israeli community, because I think to be integrated in a right way doesn't mean that you cut off from your own roots. I want to be integrated when I feel I'm proud, and I can't be proud of something that I don't own. So I have to own it to be proud of it. So this is how I navigate, and other girls in my community navigated their, you know, social navigation within the academia and within the university.
Where did you get this?
My grandmother. Feminist women. No, last point. I agree 100% with Dr. Salman about the tribal structure that we still, you know, go through it. There is a process of a change. What I'm really worried about, Salman, is that we are going from this tribal structure that is oppressing women into Islamic movement that also oppressing women. We are in a way to replace that tribal structure with the Islamic movement structure, that both of them are not my place to live. And what we are trying to do as women organization is to create the third space that can combine part of the plural Islam and part of the things, the essence of my tribal cultural structure that I still like, which is bring me with you together, because we are belonging. My mother is from your tribe, her mother is from your tribe, and this is why I like you. So it's very important. So for me, it's really very complex. There is no one theory for change. The idea is to combine all these components and bring them into the front to mobilize, organize, and mobilize people toward change. Thank you very much.
We should all thank the panelists for stimulating and some passion in their presentations. We've learned a lot, and we have a lot of questions, and they're going to be around all day and tomorrow too. And I just made that up. Thank you all very much.
If I could just give you a